All right, well, welcome back. Thank you so much to those of you who tuned into my last video. It was just amazing to see some of the reactions from all around the world. So the reactions really broke into two parts. The first was, oh my God, this is amazing. Look at what this technology can do. And the other reaction was really, oh my God, my job, what's gonna happen? In this video, we're gonna take a look at artificial intelligence and why you really don't have to worry about your job in the short term and what some of the lackings of GPT-3 are. While it's amazing in terms of what it can do, there's a lot that it can't do. I'm gonna show you some more demos of what GPT-3 is able to do in just the last week. And lastly, I'm gonna talk about why, while you don't have to worry about your jobs, there are things that we do have to worry about as a society in terms of artificial intelligence, in terms of biases for racism, sexism, and more. Let's get into it. So let's jump back to the computer and see some of the demos that have been released in the last week. So this is an example of a cool new dictionary that I saw released this week using GPT-3. And the idea of the dictionary is it's able to use context to give you the definition of a word. Most of the time, a dictionary just gives you definitions for different words that you look up. But here you can actually see that you can give it the context of the words, the bark of a tree, and then it'll give you the definition based on the context of that word. So this is an example of an image recognizer. It's using a combination of image recognition as well as GPT-3. So it's recognizing the ingredients on a package and then able to tell you whether those ingredients are good for you, bad for you, or what they actually come from. So here we see it's identifying the ingredients. It's able to find those ingredients. It's actually looking up emojis for each of those ingredients as well, and able to give you a sense if those ingredients are good for you or bad for you. So here's another example of GPT-3 working in a spreadsheet, this time in Google Docs. Similar to a demo I showed last week, it's able to complete and autocomplete formulas and equations based on what it's seeing in the surrounding area. So it has a simple function called GPT-3, which populates the data from what it sees around it. And this is a great example of a tool that can really be powerful in the hands of folks who use spreadsheets. Again, lots of people were concerned that this can eliminate jobs, but I actually think it makes it powerful to get better information and use tools more effectively. Here's another example of GPT-3 doing layout for design. And here a designer is asking for a button that looks like a watermelon, and it's generating the CSS for creating that button with the text inside of it. A button for every color of the rainbow, and it automatically produces a design that satisfies that constraint. A table of the richest countries in the world with column names and GDP. So a little bit of editing and polish. Let's see if that fixes it. It was close, but the autocomplete isn't perfect. And again, we really need to be thinking of this as a very sophisticated autocomplete. So it's not gonna replace designers or developers. It's gonna produce the beginnings of something that's incredibly useful, but it doesn't really have testing or quality associated with it. It's still up to skilled developers and designers to make sure that they use this as a starting point to produce something useful and to produce something that is well tested. So here's another one that I really like. This is a quote engine, and you can just hit refresh and it will give you a new quote every time. A bad question will beat a good answer every time. Tradition is by definition progress against the odds. The environment shapes evolution and the economy shapes society. Ultimately, evolution shapes everything. So let's do it right. Couldn't agree more. Good job, AI. And here's another design example of using text to UI within Figma. This is a variation of one of the things we saw last week. So in this example called Magicify, he's able to produce the beginnings of a web page by producing sections of that web page one at a time. So he's able to give testimonials or logos, placeholder graphics, and the UI is able to generate the beginnings of those designs. So for the developers out here, here's another technical one where you're able to type in a sentence and GPT-3 is able to produce an artificial intelligence-based SQL query that actually works within a SQL database. So really cool example of a technology. So it's able to produce and autocomplete amazing things like HTML and CSS and code and SQL statements. But the reason I say jobs aren't really at jeopardy is because it really does take a human to test these things. You need to make sure that these statements are correct, the designs are valid, that they actually work with humans, that people understand the text and the copy that it's being produced, and that it's producing content that is useful and valid. So there are four types of artificial intelligence that are important to talk about. The first is reactive machines. And so a reactive machine is basically a computer, an algorithm, and it's reacting to the environment. If you think about certain types of artificial intelligence, it's really really looking at the board of what the environment looks like, such as a chessboard or text that you give it, and reacts to that board. The second type of artificial intelligence has memory. And so it's using what it learns over time, getting smarter and smarter in terms of memory. And it's able to learn and adapt from the things that it's doing. Self-driving cars are a good example of an artificial intelligence that's learning from its environment and getting better and better as it learns. So the third type of artificial intelligence is theory of mind. And that's where you can really put yourself in someone else's shoes and imagine what they're thinking and really solve abstract problems. So for example, if I tell you, you should really click the like button. Yeah, I don't know if I should click the like button. But if you click the like button, Google will recommend my video and it'll make it easier for me to make better videos for you in the future. Well, I do like better videos, so future me would really appreciate that. So the idea of theory of mind is you can put yourself in someone else's shoes, and this is a real leap in terms of artificial intelligence. This is sometimes called general artificial intelligence, or GAI. It has all that ability of memory, it also has all that ability of a reactive machine, and it can really think and solve complex problems. The fourth type of artificial intelligence is really self-aware. That's not only where the artificial intelligence can think and put itself in the shoes of other people, but it realizes that it itself is aware of its own existence. And this is the science fiction of AI. And we're really nowhere close to number three and number four. So when you think about GPT-3, it really doesn't have a lot of memory. It's mostly a type one machine, a reactive machine. It's reacting to the text that you give it, and it's spitting out an output. And so it doesn't have memory from session to session. It doesn't learn from one behavior to another. You give it examples, and it reacts to those examples. And even in the name GPT, the PT stands for pre-training. You pre-train GPT. It's pre-trained on billions of pieces of information, but that training doesn't continue to happen as you're running the algorithm. So that's a really important distinction in terms of artificial intelligence. You can really think of it as the world's most sophisticated autocomplete. So similar to Google, it's filling in the result of a search query, something that you're giving it, and then it's predicting what the output's gonna be. Now, because of the sophistication of GPT-3, it's able to complete HTML, it's able to complete code, poetry, other language and text, and it makes it look amazingly sophisticated, but it is used an extension of that autocomplete philosophy with a lot of data and a lot of AI behind it. Now, GPT-3 is an amazing piece of technology, and I can totally understand why it would cause people to be concerned for their jobs. In fact, being concerned for employment isn't anything new, and people have been concerned for their employment with advances in technology since Aristotle and the ancient Greeks. Farmers have been concerned about plowing technology, scribes have been concerned about the printing press, typists, mathematicians, and secretaries have been concerned about computers and what that would do to their jobs. In fact, there's a term for this. It's called technological unemployment, and it's been going on for decades and centuries and centuries. And the reason I think it's not of great concern is while technology creates advances and may shift or eliminate some jobs, it often creates brand new opportunities and brand new jobs. There are a lot more people employed today than there were employed hundreds of years ago. And so it's important that we as people look at this technology as a brand new tool to allow us to build amazing technology. The thing that people should be worried about when it comes to artificial intelligence is bias. Here's a video from Chico Makea about some of the ways that biases in artificial intelligence can be problematic.
Okay, Noel, you try now. One to your hand. Too black?
Too black.
Yeah?
What I'll come do? Again.
Come again, Sashi.
Let's say a napkin and a shoulder.
Napkin again. Right, put your hand
out. What's it called on your hand?
So it's a simple example of bias, but there are lots of biases in artificial intelligence. And as we're building technology, either for autocomplete, auto-suggest, image recognition, or artificial intelligence, it's important that we think about biases and populate the databases that we're building with diverse information such that we really represent a good cross-section of all of society. Here's a video of Joy from MIT talking about some of the biases that are introduced in facial recognition as well.
Hi, I'm Joy, and I research how computers detect, recognize, and classify people's faces. In my TED featured talk, I spoke about my experience with the coded gaze, my term for algorithmic bias. The system I was using worked well on my lighter-skinned friend's face, but when it came to detecting my face, it didn't do so well. until I put on a white mask.
Joy has an amazing TEDx talk that I've linked up here in the corner, so if you want to check that out, give it a listen. As developers build tools for artificial intelligence, it's important that they think about biases, bad jokes, things that are offensive, historical inaccuracies, and more in order to build better AI and AI that is more inclusive and holistic in terms of society. This is something that OpenAI is actively thinking about. In fact, here's a tweet from Sam Altman, one of the founders of OpenAI, about how they're really thinking about bias and making sure that these applications that you're seeing demos of are properly vetted before they're released. That's one of the reasons why these application demos are available on Twitter, but they're not publicly available. These aren't apps that you can download yet because they haven't gone through that vetting process, which they're still working out. It's great to see OpenAI taking bias seriously, and I encourage other developers who are thinking about artificial intelligence or GPT-3 to think about bias and how they can make their applications more inclusive. I want to thank everyone for joining me on this video. I'm excited to announce I crossed 1,000 subscribers. Thank you so much. I love talking about entrepreneurship, design, technology, and how these things can really change the world for the better. If you like that sort of thing, you know what to do. If you have questions or want to check me out on Twitter, post other demos that you think I should highlight or other technology, I'd love to hear from you. I'm Greg Raiz. Until the next one.